We've been teaching on end times, and we've been doing a series. We've transitioned into the book of Revelation. We covered some of this information last week. I'm going to kind of try to go through to catch everybody up where we are. I'm going to do my best not to be overly redundant and to try to re-preach every single thing. As a matter of fact, I left a couple of slides out. Just one more time, Holy Spirit, I ask, Lord, for your help. I ask you to fill my mouth with your words. I yield my tongue to you, and I pray that you'd speak tonight what you desire spoken in Jesus' name. And so, right here in Revelation chapter 4, verse 1, it says, I underlined and I kind of highlighted these words, after this. And the idea is, after this, is that the preceding three chapters. If you go back and you read Revelation chapter 1 through 3, the preceding three chapters speak of the church age. We're going to talk a little bit more about that. But it's specifically a message that was given by God to Jesus and through the angel to speak to John while he was isolated and imprisoned on an island called Patmos. And you know what? I don't mind being repetitive about some of this information because I'm going to preach on John again on Sunday. To be honest with you, the message is going to come out of the book of Revelation, specifically chapter 5. And so you know what? The more you know, the easier it is for you to make connections, right? Because sometimes I talk fast, sometimes I read fast. But you know what? The more we talk about it, the more familiar you are with it, the more you catch on. Amen? Somebody told me a long time ago, they said, you know what? When I first started coming to the Bible study, I was lost. I was lost, dude. I'm going to be honest with you. But you know what it made the person do was, they said, it made me want to read the Bible. And so you know what they did? They embarked on a journey of reading the Bible. Amazing. Almost done reading the whole Bible now. Getting close. After starting from the beginning and started just working their way through. And guess what they told me a while back? I'm not really lost anymore. They're still learning. They're still a disciple. But they, whenever I talk about righteousness, they know what it means. That it's not their own acts, but it's the obedience of the righteous one. When we talk about justification, they understand what that means. When we talk about Abraham, hallelujah, they know who Abraham is. Is that really asking that much? I didn't think so. Nevertheless, if you don't read your Bible, you have a hard time keeping up with what the preacher's preaching if you don't even know who Abraham is. Now listen, if you just got saved, don't get mad at me. I'm encouraging you. Get your Bible, open it up, and surely, even if you haven't had time to read it, you've heard me say about Abraham enough times to where you know who this guy is. Amen? So anyway, I know I talk fast sometimes, but y'all just bear with me. I'll try to slow it down. After these things. After this, after the church age. And so it's after this that John says, I looked and behold, a door was opened in heaven, and the first voice which I heard was as it were of a trumpet talking with me, which said, come up hither and I will show thee things which must be hereafter. Now we mentioned this last time. I'm not going to turn to all the scriptures, but this is one of the reasons that people that teach pre-tribulation rapture, and remember, we're just trying to stay unbiased right now. That's what I'm not trying to pick a position of where I am. Some people may not like that, but I'm trying to not pick a position. I'm trying to come back to the text and let the text speak. All right? And what I'm trying to say is that just from a pre-tribulation standpoint, that's what I've always been before, the idea here is that this is part of the connection of a pre-tribulation rapture. And one of the big words in here is trumpet. Because you see, when you go to 1 Corinthians 15 and you go to 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, in both cases, it speaks of the resurrection of the dead and it speaks of it and it connects it to the sound of a trumpet. As a matter of fact, I mentioned this before, but about the feast days. I'm not going to get into this too much right now, but the first four feasts were fulfilled when Jesus came the first time. And there's three feasts that are left that take place in the month of Tishri, which is the seventh month on the Jewish calendar, which will begin in our September coming up. The Feast of Trumpets is the first feast that takes place in there. And many scholars and commentators, people that I respect greatly, connect the Feast of Trumpets to the event of the rapture. Not saying it's happening next 3 weeks from now. That's not what I'm saying. Please understand what I'm telling you. But what I am saying is that when the Feast of Trumpets gets near, I'm believing that that's whenever the rapture of the church is going to take place. I don't have time to go through and teach all the feasts again. We already did it once. It's on the video. And it's just, well, you know what? Let's just take a little bit of time. It's just, how amazing is it that the first time Jesus came, there were four feasts in the first month. First month, first Advent. In other words, the first time he came. That's what the word Advent means. He came, the first time he came. Four feasts. What feasts were they? The feast of Passover. Y'all remember that story? Passover, Exodus chapter 12. You will take a lamb, you will slice its throat, you will collect its blood. You will paint the doorpost and the sideposts of your door. When I see the blood, I will pass over you. In other words, judgment was transferred from the sinner to the lamb, and the lamb took the sin in their place. And whenever God says, when I see the blood, I will pass over you. That's why it's called Passover. Judgment has been placed on the lamb. Well, hallelujah to the Lamb. On Passover night, about 1,400 years later, Jesus was taken and betrayed and crucified. And Paul saw the connection and he said, Christ, our Passover, has been crucified for us. Amen. And so then, that started the Feast of Unleavened Bread. 7 days of not eating leaven. Not just not eating it. You couldn't have that stuff in your house, man. What is leaven? It's yeast. What does yeast do? A little leaven, leavens the whole lump. It starts spreading through. It's just like sin. You let a little bit in, next thing you know, look, if you don't know how to get a hold of Jesus, that stuff will just start taking over. Come on, somebody, you know what I'm talking about. Somebody in here has been bound up with sin before, and you know what it's like whenever sin's your master, and it's telling you where to go, and you can't say no to it. Amen. And so anyway, the Feast of Unleavened Bread, 7 days, no leaven. Jesus was unleavened bread. He was the bread from heaven. He had no leaven in him. He had no sin in him. He was the Passover. He was the unleavened bread. This is what rocked my world right here. When I realized that it was on the Feast of First Fruits that Jesus resurrected from the dead. He was crucified on Passover. He resurrected on the Feast of First Fruits. That did it for me. People have been trying to talk to me about it. I'm like, yeah, I heard. No, this shook me up, man. It made me aware. Then 50 days after the Feast of First Fruits came the day of Pentecost, the harvest feast, and lo and behold, 1,400 years later or whatever the case, on that day of Pentecost, the Holy Spirit descended in the upper room. People were filled with the Holy Ghost. Peter preached the first Holy Spirit-filled message, and 3,000 souls were added to the church on that day. Oh, man. You think that that's just coincidence? That God prepared these feasts thousands of years in advance and wrote it down in Scripture and then allowed Jesus to fulfill those things to the T like that. There's three feasts left. One feast is the Feast of Trumpets, which will be coming up in the next couple of 2-3 weeks. And I believe, according to the Scripture, it says with the sound of a trumpet, the dead in Christ will rise. And in 1 Corinthians 15, it says trumpet again. And right here, John saying, I heard a voice as of a trumpet. And that's why pre-tribulation teachers connect this portion of Scripture to the possibility of a pre-trib. This is one of the reasons, a pre-tribulation rapture. But then there's the Day of Atonement. That's the next one that happens. It's just a couple of weeks later. Actually, you know, some of the studying I've been doing, I still study up on this stuff, even though I'm not teaching it. But the part of the blowing of the trumpets was to prepare people for the Day of Atonement. The Day of Atonement was whenever the high priest would walk into the Holy of Holies. He could only go in there one time a year. I've taught this a lot. People that have been around, y'all should be so familiar with this, you can recite it in your sleep. On that mercy seat, the high priest would place blood, turning it from a place of judgment to a place of mercy. The presence of God was able to dwell with Israel because of the mercy seat and because the blood was applied to the mercy seat. So the Day of Atonement is going to have to do with the presence dwelling, being with his people. And so therefore, if the Feast of Trumpets represents the rapture, the Day of Atonement represents the second coming. And then the last feast was the Feast of Tabernacles. If you're not familiar with the Feast of Tabernacles, God demanded that his people build a hut for themselves to live in for 7 days every year. Actually, it might have been 8 days. 8 days, I believe it was, that they had to live inside of this makeshift tent or a tabernacle is what it was. They'd have to build it out of tree branches to remind them, you're a pilgrim. I brought you out of that land with my mighty hand. I saved you out of the world. I saved you out of Egypt. And I've given you a place, and you're a pilgrim on a journey, and this thing isn't over with. Amen? And listen, you and I, Peter said, you and I are pilgrims on a journey.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
You and I are pilgrims on a journey, But there's coming a day, the Word of God says, at the end of the book of Revelation, that the new heavens and the new earth are going to descend. Hallelujah. And it says, and God will tabernacle with his people. Another fulfillment of the last feast, where the literal God and the Lamb, there's no need for a sun anymore in the new heavens and the new earth, because the God and the Lamb and their glory illuminate the whole world. Hallelujah. That's a good word right there. If you can't get excited about the fact that one day you're going to be able to live in eternity with God, then you're missing the whole picture. Because God didn't create you. I'm sorry, Joel. You're wrong, dude. Joel Osteen is wrong. He didn't create you for your best life now. No. He created you to serve him, to bow your knee to him, to give your heart and to give your life to him, so that you might be a witness in the midst of a darkened land, and so that people might see that there's a God that's good, and he loves them, and he wants to set them free from their misery and their pain, yes, but so they can be a witness for him, so that they too can become part of the eternal family of God.
Yes.
I don't know about you, but I want to be part of that family.
Yes.
Hallelujah. There's nothing on this earth that can satisfy you like that.
That's right.
To give up your eternity? Come on, somebody. I know there's some things that feel good down here, but to give up your eternity? Come on. Help us, Lord. Help us to stay focused. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. All right. After this. After the church age. Well, let's move forward. And so the door was open, the sound of the trumpet, you get all that. He's going to show you things that are going to take place hereafter. I've made this little graphic, y'all don't laugh at my graphic. This has to do with a pre-tribulation rapture, all right? And so here was the first step in it. There's the church. It's supposed to represent the church age, all right? And we already talked about this. I just talked about the day of Pentecost. The Holy Spirit descended in the upper room. See, that's really what started the church age. Amen? Jesus went to the cross. He paid the sin debt. He resurrected from the dead. He walked 40 days. Hallelujah. On the earth. People saw him. There were eyewitnesses. They ate with him. Thomas stuck his finger, his hands in his side, and his finger in his hands. Or at least he was offered to. And now on the day of Pentecost, the Holy Ghost falls. Oh man, I was reading some of that stuff today. And Peter even says it. You know how all the time for you people that are regulars, I'm always talking about how God promised David that when he went to sleep with his fathers, that he was going to set up David's throne after him, and it was going to be eternal throne, 2 Samuel 7. Peter referred to that. Peter reminds the people, these people aren't drunk as you suppose. It's only the third hour of the day. It's 9 o'clock in the morning. Yeah, you hear them speaking in other tongues, but they're not drunk. This is the pouring out of the Holy Spirit that God promised. And he promised that it was going to happen related to the prophecy that had to do with David, and that Jesus is the one that came from David, and it's his eternal throne. Hallelujah. And when the Holy Spirit fell on that day and Peter started preaching that gospel, man, amen, people started being added to the church, and the church age began at the day of Pentecost. That's what it is. It's the church age. And so from there, I wanted to remind you of the signing of that covenant. Daniel chapter 9. See, because the way that I am seeing in the scriptures now, you know, somebody pointed out the other day that maybe we won't even know about that sign. You know, people do backdoor deals. Governments probably do things that you and I don't know about. That's possible. But nevertheless, this covenant will be signed. A piece of paper will be signed, and it's going to set into motion, like I told you when I taught it, a prophetic time clock.
Yeah.
That's what it says in Daniel chapter 9, verse 27, if I'm not mistaken. He, talking about the Antichrist, will confirm a covenant with many, talking about the nation of Israel. Mm. And when that document is signed, it's going to click on. Some people have even said that the word confirm means that the document could have been signed before, but then it's upheld. I don't know. That's a possibility. I don't have all the answers, but I know one thing. There's going to be something having to do with a peace treaty. And whenever that happens, it's going to start a prophetic time clock. And when that prophetic time clock starts, it's going to begin the 7-year tribulation period. So with that 7-year tribulation period, though, and these things could happen simultaneously. This guy right here is blowing a shofar. What is that? That's a trumpet. See, because I'm trying to tell you that whenever these things may happen simultaneously, that old boy might be signing a piece of paper, and the next thing you know, they're blowing the trumpet for the Feast of Trumpets, and hallelujah, the rapture takes place. You understand what I'm saying? I don't know exactly how the time or the events coincide, but I know that it's all going to be right there. And then whenever that happens, the rapture is going to happen. Amen? And then once again, this starts the tribulation period. And what I'm trying to tell you is that this is a pre-trib rapture. What do people mean by that? Well, we're about to get into the seals. And we're about to open seal number one. Seal number one, in most people's eyes, represents the tribulation, when the great tribulation starts. One of the things that I want to make a point when we get to the end of today's message, and I hope I don't forget, is that I'm seeing a difference whenever seal number six is opened. Things are a lot different once seal number six is opened. And I want to wait on that to explain it, but what I'm trying to say is this, is that the possibility of the tribulation has started, but pre-wrath rapture. In other words, I'm seeing in the scripture the possibility of that. I'm not trying to tell you I'm right and that everybody, all these other scholars are wrong. Just like I'm not trying to say that people that have taught a mid-tribulation rapture that know a whole lot more about the Bible than I ever did were right versus whoever was wrong. I'm just trying to look back at the scriptures and say, what are the possibilities and what is written in the book, and to prepare the people's hearts.
Amen.
Amen. For whatever they may face. Robert and I were talking last night. It doesn't matter what you got to go through. You better know who to hold on to. You understand what I'm saying? And you better know to hold on to Jesus. Then you better understand faith in His finished work. Why faith in His finished work? We're going to start a series Sunday night on Romans. You want to be here. I'm telling you. If you've been longing for victory in your life, you want to be here whenever we start teaching the book of Romans. And listen to me, you're going to need to know how to hold on to Jesus, and you're going to need to know how to access Him through faith in His finished work. Because when you know how to hold on to God, you receive grace through your faith. But your faith has to be right.
Amen.
What are you talking about? Your faith has to be in the right object.
Amen.
Not just in your confession. That's what the word of faith taught all those years. Oh, you got to say the right stuff all the time. You got to get up every morning and you got to put on your armor, shod your feet with the preparation of the gospel of peace, gird your loins with truth, put on your breastplate of righteousness, take up your shield of faith, take out your sword of the Spirit, put on your helmet of salvation. Hold on a second. Time out. Well, I hit snooze too many times this morning. You telling me that now I'm just meat for the devil? The roaring lion's going to just kill me? No, hallelujah. It's not up to Matt.
Right.
It's up to Jesus. And Jesus is the helmet of my salvation. He's my breastplate of righteousness because He's the righteous one. He's the sword of the Spirit because He's the living Word of God. He is the gospel of the peace. Because He's the Prince of Peace. What I'm trying to say is that when you put your faith in Christ, the Lord put you in Christ and you became clothed with Him. Hallelujah. And I don't know about you, but I don't want to take Him off.
That's right.
I want to go to bed in Him and I want to wake up in Him. Now, let me back up a second. In case you woke up this morning and you did all that. I used to do it too. All right? It's all good.
Amen.
You can keep doing it if that's what you want to do. I'm set free from that. It's not about Matt's performance and his religious duty. It's about faith in the finished work of the righteous one. And that gives me access to grace. You need scripture for that. Romans chapter 5 verse 3. Therefore, being justified. What does it mean to be justified? To be declared righteous by God. How? Because you put faith in Jesus, the righteous one. And when you did that, you were clothed with Him. Therefore, being justified by faith, we have peace with God, and we have access into this grace in which we stand. Oh, hallelujah. That's a good word. Access to grace. Amen. So anyway, here we are, pre-tribulation rapture. Tribulation starts, and the great tribulation starting, and now we're opening up, we're getting close to opening up these seals, okay? And so here we are. John saw elders. You know, I wasn't going to spend a whole lot of time on this, but I want to remind you because we're going to, I know already, I can see a portion of scripture that I'm going to be preaching on Sunday. These elders are clothed in white raiment. That's the righteousness of Jesus that's been clothed on you. Do you understand that righteousness is not as much about your performance? Don't get me wrong. I'm not trying to tell you you can run around here doing whatever you want to do. That's not what I'm saying. But what I'm trying to tell you is, if you don't have a revelation of what true righteousness is, you're going to attempt to perform and produce your own righteousness
yeah.
in your own strength through your own performance instead of learning how to rest in what He did.
Amen. Amen.
Come unto me, you who are weary and heavy laden.
Yes.
You take my yoke upon you. My yoke is easy and my burden is light, and you will find rest for your weary souls. Is your soul weary? Does anybody got a weary soul up in here? I don't know what's going on whenever you go home and you turn the lights out. I don't know what's going on inside your heart and in your head. But I'm here to tell you, if you're growing weary, you can find rest in Jesus. Let yourself be yoked up with Him. He wants to be the workhorse, amen, in this relationship. And so when you're clothed with the righteousness of Christ, now you're in the righteousness. And now you have access to grace. Amen? White raiment. Clothed in the righteousness of Christ. Amen? All right. Also, these elders, they had crowns. They had gold crowns. And last week I explained to you that the crown was specifically in the Greek language, the Stephanos, and it describes the victor's crown. So this is this kind of crown that was given to people that won in the Grecian games or the Roman games. And so these elders have a victory crown. But what I want you to know is that the crown that's given to the believer, I want you to know that crown, the victory that you and I wear on our head whenever we get to heaven, it's not really our crown. You understand that? Because it wasn't our victory. Amen. It was His victory that we partook in. Does that make sense what I'm trying to say? See, that's the problem that we have most times in the modern church. We're trying to produce our own victory. We're trying to do our own work. We're trying to accomplish it in our own strength instead of learning how to trust and keep faith in the victory of the victorious one. He's the one with the crown, and He lets us partake in His victory. And that's what this word, this type of crown is. It's the victor's crown. And so when you see these elders in heaven, and it talks about them, round about the throne were 24 seats, meaning 24 seats. Upon the seats I saw 24 elders. They were clothed in white raiment. That's talking about the righteousness again. And they had their heads with, they had crowns of gold. Amen? And, you know, so I think in Revelation 5, verses 9 and 10, I'll put that right there. I'm going to be preaching out of chapter 5 Sunday, but anyway. And they sung a new song, saying, Thou art worthy to take the book, to open the seals thereof, for you were slain and have redeemed us to God by thy blood, out of every kindred and tongue and people and nation, and has made us unto our God kings and priests, and we shall reign on the earth. So He's the King of kings, amen, and the Lord of lords. But His victory we now partake of, and He makes us kings and priests on this earth, and we rule and reign with Him. You don't even have to. This is one of the things that I keep reminding myself. For people that say that, you know, the cross is old news, because look, I've run into many people, maybe you haven't, I've run into a lot of people that try to come against the teaching about the cross, and they don't understand it, because they think it's just we're just talking about the physical torture that Jesus, no, we're not, we're talking about the spiritual victory that Jesus accomplished when He died on the cross. You understand, I was talking to somebody on the phone yesterday, and I was trying to explain to him that, you know, about whether it be addiction or whatever you want to call it. Whatever you want to call it. Mankind's got his own terminology and his own answer that he wants to tell us. He's got something figured out. You received an addiction from your father. Okay, and he had it from his father. In other words, it's in your DNA. But the problem is they never found that on anybody's DNA. You understand that? They can't find that on anybody's DNA because there's no addiction gene. That's not the problem. The problem is it's called sin. And yes, you received some bad DNA from your daddy, But it wasn't Jim, that's my daddy's name. It was Adam, your daddy Adam. Because all mankind flows forth from the loins of Adam. We all in this place find ourselves as part of Adam's fallen race. You don't have to believe that if you don't want to. Believe what the psychologist tells you. Believe what the addictionologist tells you. That's what he told me when I went to go get my nursing license, man. I'm telling you, oh, Lord, help me. I don't want to take up too much time. But they told me, oh, whenever I answered yes, I have done that right there. It threw me into a whole new algorithm. Next thing you know, I'm over there sitting down in this guy's office in New Orleans. I'm like, yeah, but I'm a Christian now. Yeah, 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 that's real good. So you're going to be, so what did you do? Can I tell y'all the truth? You used to break into houses? You did that? Well, people don't do that unless they're on drugs. Well, okay. I guess you got to say that, but I'm thinking, yeah, I guess you got a point there. That's what I was doing it for. But nevertheless, so that was you, dude, and you're always going to be that way is what he's basically telling me. But I'm trying to say something that the Bible says is something different.
Amen.
You don't want to hear that. Mankind doesn't want to hear what the Bible says. Man and his intellect in this new intellectual world that we live in that's got stuff figured out and technology and everything. I mean, you believe that if you want to. I wrote it in my book. Some psychologist or psychiatrist told that boy, and there was somebody preaching in the crowd, and he said that, and there were demon spirits speaking in his ear because that preacher was telling him, you can be set free by the blood of the Lamb. And there was a demon spirit whispering in his ear, that preacher's lying. You remember what that psychiatrist told you? You're going to be addicted for the rest of your life. I'm here to tell you that's a lie from the pit of hell. That Jesus can set the captive free. Whatever it is that ails you, whatever it is that binds you, Jesus can set the captive free. You might not feel it today. You might not feel it tomorrow. But it don't mean that the blood doesn't work. You hear what I'm trying to say? When his blood poured out, when he breathed his last breath, he said, it is finished. The work was done. And he sat down. I'm here to tell you, there's victory in the finished work of Christ.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. So we're walking in his victory. And that's what the Stephanos was. We partake in his victory. Amen. So we're about to open up the seals, and one of the first things I wanted to point out to you is that in the first four seals, we hear the concept of the four horsemen, all right? And so seal 1, 2, 3, and 4 are connected to the four horsemen specifically of the apocalypse. Seal number 1 has to do with a white horse. I was just looking for some pictures to put up there, and I saw this white horse, and I like the fact that he had a bow in his hand, but he didn't have any arrows, and you see all these skulls. And after I put that there, I was like, man, that's a pretty cool little picture you got there. And I started thinking to myself, but that's not what he's going to look like. Because you see, the white horse is the counterfeit Christ. The white horse is the Antichrist. The opening of the first seal releases the Antichrist. And he's not going to come over here holding a bunch of skulls up. He doesn't want you to know what he's doing. The word of God says in the book of Daniel, see, the reason he doesn't have arrows is because he's coming in peace. The word of God says in the book of Daniel that he's going to overtake through flatteries. And I was looking that word up this morning in my phone app. And what the word flatteries means is it means through fine language and just slippery. He speaks in riddles, Daniel also said. And so he's going to say one thing out of his mouth, but there's hidden meaning underneath that's really going on. And whenever you want to talk about change, yeah, he's going to give you change, all right. And as a matter of fact, the word of God says that he's going to change time. Times and seasons, and he's going to change laws. Kind of interesting, huh? But anyway, well, we might even mention some of that, and I think we will. But I started thinking, that's not what he's going to look like. He's going to be pretty. And what I mean by pretty is he's going to be pleasing. People are going to want him. They're going to say, yes, come fix our mess. We're in the midst of a mess. I shared with y'all a while back that video that Greta Van Susteren did, and I actually have the picture tonight in the teaching that she used on her screen to say, we need one world ruler to step up. We need one world ruler to step up and to lead us because it's getting bad. There's chaos out there, and there's fear and pandemonium, and it's striking our heart, and we need somebody to help us, and we need all these nations to come together. I'm not saying Greta knows exactly what she's saying.
Right.
I'm not saying that Fox News could be part of the whole thing. I'm not saying that Rupert Murdoch, who owns it, could own other stuff and that they could be purposefully deceiving us. That's not what I'm necessarily saying, but what I am saying saying is that that's the spirit of Antichrist. The spirit of Anti, you may not like that. Oh, dude, don't mess with Bill O'Reilly. He's the no-spin zone. He's telling me the truth. Come on, somebody. Them people are puppets. They're spewing out of their mouth. Come on, help me now.
Prophecy.
You think that they're going to really tell you the truth of what's really going on behind the scenes? They're trying to play Democrat against Republican. They know that I'm not going to get into all that. Listen, people are going to want him. They're going to want this guy to come save them from their mess. I'm going to challenge you. You may not like me, but I'm going to try my best to tell you the truth. I'm going to challenge you. Because this world is not what you perceived it to be. And now's the time to wake up. Now's the time to have my eyes open as we near closer and closer towards the end. You're not going to fix it in a voting booth. Am I telling you not to go vote? That's not what I'm saying. But you're not going to fix it in a voting booth. You're going to need to get a hold of Jesus. Amen. Because listen to me. I've said it before and I thank you, Lord. I'll say it again. Do you not think it's strange that Obamacare passed and that the Supreme Court justices outweigh conservatively the liberals? How did that happen? You tell me. Because I was told I was supposed to vote for a conservative president so that he would nominate conservative people on the bench. And nevertheless, somehow, oh, it's a tax thing. Well, the other four conservatives didn't think it was a tax thing, sir. So how did you figure that out? What happened there? Is this all a ploy? Are we just a bunch of little robots and we're just going through life? Yeah, tell us what you want us to hear. Oh, we believe everything you say. And then the next thing you know, gay marriage. Now that's passed. Oh, you're not supposed to say that, preacher. No, you can say that. The Word of God says that it's an abomination.
Amen.
I'm not trying to pick on a homosexual. It's an abomination for some, a lot of the stuff that Matt's done. It's an abomination in the eyes of God. Sin is an abomination in the eyes of God.
Right.
But you can't say that it's okay for a man and a man to be married, because the Word of God says that it's a man and a woman. Hallelujah. And listen, all of a sudden, still we got 5 conservatives to 4 liberals, but lo and behold, they figured out some kind of way to make it happen. Do what you want with that, but you're not going to fix it in a voting booth. I hate to tell you. Yeah, pick the best one. Vote for the best one. Vote, pray, and ask the Lord to lead you. But they're going to want this guy when he shows up, because the world's going to be already in the midst of chaos. The world, we hadn't even seen. That night that Greta said the day that I found that video and showed it, that night ISIS killed those Marines in America.
Yeah, they're already calling the Pope the Prince of Peace.
Well, yeah, that surprised me, calling the Pope the Prince of Peace.
Yeah. It could be that.
Well, I think that I've already said it. I'm going to say it again. I think the Pope will end up being the false prophet connected to a world leader.
Yeah.
I've already, it's documented. It's on video, so there's no sense in shrinking back now. True. So here we go. Revelation 6:2, and I saw, and behold, a white horse, and he that sat on him had a bow, no arrows, and a crown was given unto him. You know, I find that interesting. Because I always thought about the concept of the crown being given unto him, and that ultimately you got to understand that God is sovereign. And so God is allowing this Antichrist person to come on the scene. And part of the reason that God is allowing this to happen is ultimately to bring judgment on a disobedient world.
Mm-hmm.
It's what it says in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, because they refuse to believe the truth, he will send them strong delusion.
Mm-hmm.
They wanted a lie. They didn't want the truth. I keep picking on that poor doctor I met in Anytime Fitness. But he didn't want the truth. And because they wanted a lie, he's going to give them what they wanted.
Yes.
And he's going to come. I'm telling you, he's going to have the flattery words. He's going to have all the answers. And the reality of it is, he's going to be a liar.
Yeah.
And he's going to be setting people up for deception. But it's given unto him. You know, one of the things that I thought about that was that, you know, I personally believe, and this is just my opinion. I always like to share that whenever I think it's my opinion. I believe that there's more to, yes, God is sovereign and in control and he's allowing this to happen. But I believe that to some extent that given unto him has to do with humanity. And what I mean by that is this. Humanity with their free will is allowing this to happen, actually purposefully causing it to happen. Now, I don't have time to get into the occult, to get into the whole occult world that's been going on since, I'm talking about hieroglyphics on Egyptian walls. You understand what I'm saying? This didn't just show up Illuminati in 1776. Right. This stuff's been going on since the garden, whenever the enemy of the mankind's soul caused them and told them, the day that you eat thereof, you will not die, but instead you will know. Bing, your eyes are going to be opened. The occult world calls that initiation, just as the Christian church has their own word called born again. Whenever you're dead to sin and you give your life to Christ and you become born again, your eyes are open to the things of God. That's why Jesus told Nicodemus, unless a man is born again, he cannot see, nor can he enter into the kingdom of God.
Amen. That's right.
You think that they did that on accident? If you didn't read my book, you don't know what I'm talking about. But you think they did that on accident? That icon, that bitten apple? No, there's a reason for that. Well, why you use it, preacher? Because I use it for good. Amen? It's a reason. The first Apple computer sold for $666.66. Do what you want with that. I guess it was an accident. Coincidence. My point is that this thing has been on the earth causing deception, the spirit of Antichrist moving and operating through, and it's been done in such a way that you can't even see the reality anymore. A facade has been painted. I can't remember what the name of that movie was. What was the name of that movie? But a guy lived inside of a movie set.
Oh.
Jim Carrey.
Yeah. Truman Show.
Truman Show. He thought he was that, like that was his real world. And one day he found the door. He was trying to walk out. What I'm trying to tell you is that the world that we've been living in is not exactly the way that we perceived it. But it's okay. Because what was real is Jesus. And what is real is the Word of God. And if we'll learn how to hold on to that, we're going to be okay no matter what we face. Amen? All right. And so it says right here that he was on a white horse. He had a bow and a crown was given unto him. And I'm doing a bad job of trying to articulate what I'm trying to say. But what I want you to know is that just as the Holy Spirit uses the free will of man and he uses man as vessels to bring forth his plan, the enemy of our soul, under secrecy, through secret societies and occult black magic, has been for thousands of years using human beings as vessels, some of the most powerful human beings in the world, as vessels through which he has been enacting his own plan. That's why the Word of God says in Psalm chapter 2 that the kings of the earth have set themselves against God. That's why we see in Revelation 17 a seven-headed beast of kings that have been in bed with the Antichrist system and have been against God. It's written in the scriptures. And so it's time that we start to realize these things. And so it's given unto him. Y'all remember that time I read that quote from Alice Bailey, who was an occultist? Her prayer she taught everybody was this: come, Lord of light, come and bring your peace upon the earth. Lord of light. You'd think she was talking about Jesus. No, she wasn't. She was Lucifer, the bearer of light. That's what they called him. And so there's millions of these people. And they just do a better job. See, the Word of God says that the enemy does things in the darkness and that evil, wicked men hide their deeds in the dark, whereas God does everything in the light. See, God tells his people to be light in the midst of darkness, to shine the light of the truth in the midst of darkness. The enemy hides everything in darkness. I probably shouldn't have got into all this, but I will say this. I learned this first from one of the people in the church, that Anita Fuentes had brought this up. She's a girl that does like a news show. Whenever Joe Biden and Obama went to Denver, they chose Invesco Field, which is the Denver Broncos stadium, and that's the mascot, the white horse up there, to speak there. Now, I'm not telling you that this is what really happened. That's not what I'm saying, but I think it's interesting. Conspiracy theorists were making the point that this could have been the first seal being opened up. All right, that he's the Antichrist, that he was speaking here purposefully, that they had that white horse in the background connected to the first seal of the book of Revelation. All right, My only point in bringing this up is I'm not saying that that's necessarily what happened, because if that was the case, that was 8 years ago. And in reality, the first seal, if we believe in a seven-year tribulation, 3.5 years should have been mid-tribulation. And so we're about to be at the end, because this actually happened August the 8th of 2008. So right now, in August, we made 7 years. So that means that really and truly, Jesus would be coming back, because that would be the second coming. Wouldn't it be interesting if all of a sudden some dude stood up and said that it looked like he was the one on the white horse? You don't understand what I'm saying? Like a fake? Anyway, I'm not saying that that's what happened, but what I did want to point this out for is this. Is that I believe that the Lord put on my heart, and you do what you want with this, because this is my opinion too, that the enemy for thousands of years has been working a false pre-tribulation tribulation. Mm. What are you talking about? Setting up a major deception to the point that whenever it happens, people believe that this is it. And the reality of it is that it may not be it at all. And it's layer of deception upon layer of deception upon layer of deception. And the people of God are so confused, because they've been told one thing all of their life, and they weren't ready for the possibility that they were thrown a curveball. And all of a sudden, people start defecting from the faith. So I'm not trying to say that that's what this was, but I am trying to say this, that the enemy of your soul has been at work. And he's been working some serious deceit. And so anyway, that's another picture of the stadium. And that's, I Googled that. New York Times said that that speech took place August the 8th of 2008.
That's good.
The crown was given unto him. Seal number two is talking about war. I don't even really know that I have time to turn to these scriptures, because I got to get through these seals. And I really waited. I went too far on my rabbit trails today. But out of Daniel chapter 7 and also Revelation 13... it speaks of, see, the red horse, the rider on the red horse, he has a sword. And it's this horse of war. And in Daniel 7 and in Revelation 13, I was noticing today, and I went ahead and made a slide for it, these connections that are so close to one another. Let's see if I can do what I'm trying to do here. Anyway, you see verse 21, it says he made war. I had to cut some of the verse out. He made war with the saints and he prevailed against them. Now, real quick, I've already explained that the word saints is used in the book of Revelation multiple times, and that the word literally means hagios, or separated out one, and that some commentators describe the word saints as it could refer to the Jewish people that are coming to Christ that missed the tribulation. So a pure pre-tribulational guy has to figure out a way to talk about these saints that are in there. It could also be people that have been awakened to the truth of Jesus after the rapture took place. Or a mid-tribulation guy would tell you, well, no, that's because the church is still going to be here. And they're going through it. Okay, I'm just telling you what the different opinions would be. And so, but in the book of Daniel, it says that it's talking about the Antichrist. He makes war with the saints and he prevailed over them. And then what I wanted you to see here was the similarity of this verse out of Revelation 13. And it was given unto him to make war with the saints and to overcome them. And then in this one here it says, and he, talking about the Antichrist, shall speak great words against the Most High. And then it says right here, and he opened his mouth in blasphemy against God. And then right here it says, a time, times, and dividing of times. It's talking about power was given to him, and I'm going to explain that in a second. And then over here it says, and power was given unto him 42 months. And so a time, times, and the dividing of times, I told y'all this one before, but time equals 1 year. Times, plural, equals 2 years, and the dividing of times equals a half a year. And so you have 1 + 2 + 1/2 is 3.5 years, 3.5 years, 42 months. If you do it according to the Jewish calendar, which is a lunar calendar, that there and it's 30 days in a month, it comes out to exactly 3.5 years. And so the point I'm just trying to make, show you the similarities, and it's all having to do with war. And it's having to, and the terminology, I just want to remind you, this is one of the things that kept ringing in my spirit 3 years ago when I was listening to the book of Revelation, bringing my girls to school. I kept listening to it over and over again, and I couldn't believe how many times it kept saying, this requires patient endurance of the saints. This requires patient endurance of the saints. Once again, I'm not here to tell you that we're going to be here through the whole thing. It just kept ringing in my spirit. This requires patient endurance of the saints. I just want to be ready for whatever. And like Robert said last night, keep your eyes on Jesus and you'll be ready for whatever you go through. Amen?
Amen.
There went out another horse. He was red. Power was given to him that sat thereon to take peace from the earth and that they should kill one another. And there was given unto him a great sword. So it's talking about war. A bow without arrows, a false peace, and take peace from the earth. So he's going to start off with flattery words, smooth speech, and he's going to speak in riddles. And he's going to take the hearts of the people. And then as soon as he gets where he wants to come, the lies are going to be revealed and the war is going to start. And then seal number three, it says, and when he had opened the third seal, I heard the third beast say, come and see. I beheld, lo, a black horse, and he that sat on him had a pair of balances in his hand. So the idea is that after war, famine, and death are the natural results of war, and we see the scales follow the sword. Remember, we're talking about the first four seals or the first four horsemen. You have the first seal opens up and the Antichrist comes forth. The second seal opens up and war starts. The third seal opens up and we have famine. One of the interesting things that I'm seeing here is this, and this is something that the Lord put in my heart whenever I first started to write my book a while back, was that all these things, ultimately, let me be clear, the Lamb opened the seal, right? Mm-hmm. So that means ultimately God is sovereign and in control. The Lamb opened the seal and he allowed all this stuff to be released. That's part of what I'm going to be preaching on Saturday. The seals have to be opened. As much pain as it's going to cause, in order for God's plan to go forward, the seals must be opened. And the Lamb opened the seal, but at the same time, all of these things that are following so far could easily be contrived by an Antichrist person, could they not? Could he not be the one that starts the war? Could he not be the one that causes famine? Absolutely. And that's the point that I'm trying to make, is that the enemy could, after he's given the ability to come forth and to be revealed, he could be the one behind it. But once again, ultimately, God is in control and he's allowing all this stuff to be played out for mankind to be judged. So it says, a measure of wheat for a penny and three measures of barley for a penny, and see that you hurt not the oil and the wine. There's a couple of different interpretations about the oil and the wine. Some people would say that that means that the very, very elite won't be hurt during this time yet. Because, you know, it seems as though when these first seals are opened up is whenever humanity in general is being hit hard. But then really and truly it's in Revelation 18 that you see financial Babylon is destroyed by God. And in financial, that's after the wrath of God has just demolished this whole Babylonian system that's been going on since the Tower of Babel. We don't have time to get into all that, but this thing's been in existence since the Tower of Babel. And in Revelation 18, God's going to bring financial Babylon. Now, we don't have time to open that can of worms. To an end.
Amen.
Actually, I've preached on that in the last 15 minutes. It was called A Debt Slave. And if you can go on our YouTube account and you can watch Debt Slave. And in the end of it, I talk about the Babylonian financial system, the Rothschild Empire, and all of that kind of stuff like that. But anyway, the measure of wheat for a penny and three measures of barley for a penny, see that you hurt not the oil and the wine. The oil and the wine, only the richest of the elite could still have that. And so they aren't hurt yet. And it's the common man that is. In Matthew 20 verse 2, the same word penny there is really a denarius. And in that parable, you remember Jesus is telling a story of a landowner. He hired some people early in the morning and they started working. He hired some people kind of like midday and then somebody right like the last hour. And whenever he went to divvy up, he gave them all the same amount. And the ones that had been working all day were all mad about it, right? But the idea is that a denarius or a penny is the way it's translated, was one day's wage. And so the idea here is that, and once again, it was a one day's wage. That was a Roman denarius. But I kind of missed the point. I must have lost my slide. The point I wanted to make was that in that day, one day's wage would buy one meal of wheat or three meals of barley, because barley would have been a little bit cheaper. Almost like if you had, you know, some foods. I remember, I don't know, I think one time, you know what, I meant to say this too. I remember for Andrew, anybody here old enough to remember Andrew? I'm talking about the hurricane. Whenever we got to the famine part, I wanted to say that you might think I'm crazy, but you might, it may not be a bad idea to get a little extra stuff.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I remember telling somebody one time about, you know, hey man, a little bit of wisdom, have, you know, maybe a month's supply of some things. And they were like, man, look, God fed Elijah with the raven. Like, you're right. And he could certainly feed you with, like he fed Elijah. But my point is this. I remember Andrew, and I remember whenever that went down, and I went out there and I stood in the line just because I do crazy stuff like that, because we weren't really hurting that bad. They were giving out some commodities and stuff like that. I ain't going to stand out no line again to go get no commodities if I can help it. Don't get me wrong now. I'm hungry enough. God only knows what I'll do. But I can remember standing in that line and the National Guard walking around with their automatic weapons. Then all of this stuff going on. And all I'm trying to say is this. Even if we don't have to go through a pre-tribulation, even if we are taken out of here pre-tribulation, it may not be a bad idea as things get going crazy that you have a little bit of extra stuff stored away. But this is what I'm trying to say. It may not be a bad idea to stock up a little bit on some things just so you don't have to go out and have to be in the midst of chaos to get a whole bunch of stuff in case something happens. That's all I'm trying to get at. Yes, a little bit of wisdom.
Yeah.
Some people are like, yeah, but I can't afford it. You can afford what you want to afford, bro, sis, whatever. You understand what I'm trying to say? Whatever you got going on in your life, you find a way to buy that stuff, the stuff you want. Come on, somebody. All right. But it's just not real to me. When that hunger starts gnawing on your belly, it's going to be real. I know. Preacher got some food. All right, so this is the fourth horse. The fourth horse is a pale horse. The first horse is white, second horse is black, third horse is red. You're not really supposed to say that kind of stuff like I just did. I mean, if we were in the midst of a mid-tribulation thing,
yeah.
The Word of God says that a child is going to turn in their parent.
Mm-hmm.
You understand how bad that is?
Yes.
That means my daughter is so hungry. And look, she ain't even all about food. She'll forget to eat for days. And that girl, like, I was thinking, if I was like Scott Bailey, I'd just go kill me some animals and it ain't that big of a deal. She got a picture the other day. She sees a rabbit, a wild rabbit, and she sits down like this, and that rabbit comes and like sticks his head all up on her hand. She's like, the little, you know, whistling and the animals are coming out at her. So I don't know, I might have to follow her around. Maybe we can get some rabbits that way. But I don't even know what I was trying to say. My point is, I lost my train of thought. Lord help me. All right, we're on these horses. Fourth horse, I need to hurry up. I know y'all's time is precious. Fourth horse is called a pale horse. You got the white horse, you got the black horse. I'm sorry, the red horse is war. Black horse is famine. Pale horse. The word really in the Greek is chloros. You don't spell it like that. That's how we would translate it in English. In Greek, it's spelled like this. It's got a... That's how you would spell it in Greek, because the chi makes the k sound, chloros. But when you translate it like this. It's where we get the word chlorine from, and the chlorine gas is green. And the idea of the pale horse or chloros is a green horse. See, the green is the color of death. And I'm not going to get into that too much. But one of the things that's interesting to me is I've been kind of looking at this for a while. When you look at Islam, and you look at the color. See this flag right here? This Islamic flag is actually the Arab revolt flag. And it's got all four of those colors in it. It's got red, it's got white, it's got green, it's got black. And I was just thinking, would it not be an interesting thought? Could the four horsemen, this is just a thought, once again, Matt's opinion. I didn't read this in anybody's commentary. This is something that I remember Adam Mesh mentioned something a long time ago about Islam. But this is kind of like how the Lord helped to put it in my mind. Could the four horsemen be the Antichrist, the white horse opened up, and his use of the Islamic religion as his tools of war, famine, and death? I mean, we're seeing Islam and what they're doing. We're seeing ISIS and what's happening. And I'm just, I don't even have time to get into all that. But I don't even think that that's accidental. This didn't just happen on accident. I think that there's powers that are more forceful and bigger and more powerful that are actually behind that whole movement that are pushing that whole thing forward. Do you ever see Iron Man, the one where, I think it was the latest, was it the latest Iron Man? The last Iron Man, I think it was. I haven't been to the movie in 2 years, I don't think. But anyway, the latest Iron Man, I saw it. And they had this Arab dude. He wasn't really Arab, he was English. But they had him all fixed up and he looked Arab. They brushed his face and put the beard on him. And he spoke with a, you know, Pakistani, you know, I'm not going to try to deal because I laugh. But then he was on TV. And, you know, he's the face of terror. And they put this face out there, the face of terror. But behind the scenes, see, y'all don't know that, but Hollywood's sending information. We just don't know it because we're just robots. And in the movie itself, after the TV thing goes off, the next thing you know, oh, the people are taking his beard off. And they're like, okay, get ready for the next shot that we're going to do. And the reality of it is that the forces that be that were behind it, that were bigger and more powerful, had actually just hired an actor to act like he was the face of terror, and they broadcast this all over the world, and everybody's just believing whatever it is that they're telling them. And so all I'm trying to say is that in my personal opinion, I believe there's something even bigger behind the force of this Islamic thing, the Arab Spring. Y'all remember when that happened? And all of a sudden, nobody likes their leader anymore. It all happened within about a 2 week period. Y'all remember that? Egypt don't want their leader. I don't even remember them all. Syria, they don't want their leader. Saudi Arabia, they don't want their leader. And everybody's in an uproar. It all happened at the same time. And then they switch some stuff around and the next thing you know, it's over with. I got a problem with that. I'm not so naive anymore that I just believe everything that they tell me. What I'm trying to say is that I believe that there's a force on the earth, human beings that have sold their soul to the devil. How else do I explain that to you? And they're the most powerful people in the world. And they own the banking industry. And they have people like George Soros. I put all this stuff on video. George Soros, a multi-billionaire who toppled the Grecian economy 4 years ago. He did that and he was bragging about it. He works for the Rothschilds. What I'm trying to say is that these people, listen, there's a book called Pawns in the Game. They found a horse rider with documents. He was struck by lightning. And it's talked about the Bavarian Illuminati and the House of Rothschild. And these people, you can Google it. Google Rothschild Dynasty. You're going to see them. They're still alive. Mm-hmm. They own the banks. They tell us that Bill Gates is the richest man in the world. What? Mm-hmm. That's so hilarious. Mm-hmm. And what I'm trying to say is that there's a force behind these things that are manipulating the world that we live in. Nobody wants to talk about it, but it's time that we see it and realize, because guess what? He that is in us is greater than he that's in the world. Seal number five. Thank you, Jesus.
Yes.
Souls under the altar. When seal number five is opened up, that's what it says. Revelation 6, verses 9 through 11. I'll read it to you real quick. When he opened the fifth seal, I saw under the altar the souls of them that were slain for the word of God and for the testimony which they held. They cried with a loud voice, saying, "How long, O Lord, holy and true, dost thou not judge and avenge our blood on them that dwell on the earth?" And white robes were given unto every one of them, and it was said unto them that they should rest yet for a little season, until their fellow servants also and their brethren that should be killed as they were should be fulfilled. So when the fifth seal's open, you see souls under the altar. They're given white robes, and they must wait for their brethren to die. I was just finding a picture. I just Googled, you know, souls under the altar. So I'm thinking, you know, this is the brazen altar. This represents the cross in the Old Testament where the animal was sacrificed. And these souls are under the altar because there's a, you know, the Word of God teaches us that there's that the physical tabernacle or temple on earth was a shadow of that which is created in the heart and mind of God. But I was thinking, you know, maybe that's what it looks like on in heaven. I don't really know. But I was thinking that at the same time that's going on in heaven, this is what's happening on earth. Yeah. People, that's the picture that Greta used. This is ISIS. And they got these people lined up. And they're about to, you know what they're, all they're asking them to do is just one simple thing. It's not really that difficult, guys. All you got to do is say no. All you got to do is say no. I don't believe in Jesus. Yes. I don't believe that he's the savior of the world. And that instead I believe Allah is the prophet. And it's a done deal. It's simple. You just say, you just reject Jesus. And then guess what? We let you up. You dust the sand off your knees and you go on home. You take care of your family. But that's not what these people are doing. That's not what these people are doing. They're saying, no, you go ahead and get the knife. And finish up the business. And so anyway, I just wanted to point that out. Seal number six, and we're closing. I beheld when he had opened the sixth seal, and lo, there was a great earthquake. Now, one of the, and he goes on to say, and the sun became black as sackcloth of hair, and the moon became as blood. And there's a lot of information out there about blood moons, but look, it says right there, and the moon became as blood. Now, one of the things that's interesting to me is this, and I've read it in two different sources, that whenever there's a certain phenomenon that takes place. And this is what bears witness with my spirit. I do think it's crazy that blood moons happen on Jewish holidays time after time again. I can't explain it all, and it's whatever the case. But one thing I know is this, is that they say that whenever smoke enters the atmosphere, or when a volcano erupted one time and threw ash into the atmosphere, that it caused the moon to turn red like blood because you're viewing it through these substances and particles. So there's a great earthquake, and the sun becomes black like sackcloth of hair. In other words, the sun doesn't shine anymore like it's supposed to. And the moon became as blood. Whether it's that or whether it's an astronomical phenomenon, I don't really know. But one thing I do know is this. To me, this changes everything. And what I'm trying to say is this. This is what's happening. The moon turns red like blood. The sun becomes black. And the stars start to fall from heaven.
Wow.
Now, this is different than everything else that we talked about before. What I mean by that is that when the first seal was opened up and the rider on the white horse came forth, the next thing we saw was war. He could have manufactured that. Next thing we saw was famine. He could have manufactured that. Next thing we saw was a horse that caused, you know, death or whatever the case, the chloros. And that's all part of it. He can't manufacture this.
No.
Whenever the earth starts to quake and the blood turns red like the moon turns red like blood and the sun doesn't shine and stars start falling from heaven, this is a transition point in the whole thing that's different than everything that went before it. This is literally, at least in my eyes, I would call this the wrath of God being poured out upon mankind. We're going to close right there and we'll pick it up right there when we come back.